We move on to the infrastructure. Maybe many of you may be knowing, for building a vehicle, maybe few hundred crores are required. For building the same vehicle of 100 crores, 1,000 crores of investment is required towards infrastructure. We have huge facilities at SDSC SHAR as well as IPRC, who takes care of stage integration and the production plants. Asia's largest production solid motor production plant is there in India at SDSC SHAR. Many of you may not be aware. Such kind of process facilities require huge electronics, either for operating the different machines like PLCs, etc., etc., for controlling the accessing the facilities. You can name any kind of electronics that will be there in these facilities, IPRC and SDSC SHAR. Unfortunately, the person from IPRC could not make it up, but we have friends from SDSC SHAR. The day of launch, huge activities will be there for launching micro, especially for tracking, telemetry, support systems like CCTV, communication, timing, etc., etc., which are very hidden things. They are not light components, but they are electronics. We have Dr. B.V. Subbarao, who is general manager, who is instrumental in realizing multi-object tracking radar, which is unique technological marvel, first of its kind in India. He is instrumental and he is the person behind developing two PCMC C-band and S-band radars, first time in India through L&T. Mr. B.V. Subbarao.
Respected Director CBCO and AD CBPO and dear ISRO colleagues and industry delegates, good evening to all of you. Yeah, green. Actually, everybody thinks that SDSC Satish Dhawan Space Center is a spaceport of India, and which is a launching facility. But okay, that is initial stages. Now it is also having lot of development areas are there for with the growing demand for the satellites. And every year, we are also participating for 10 to 12 launches. And for that, the capacity also to be built up. Okay, so capacity building is also going on for all the areas, propellant side, as Sudhir told, and the instrumentation side. So I will touch upon instrumentation. My colleague will tell the process instrumentation. So coming to the range instrumentation, it is responsible for the electronics instrumentation activities during the rocket launchings. In that, there are tracking systems and radars. Radars are there, and optical tracking systems and telecommand, and electronics interfacing system, which consists of CCTV and fiber optics links, timing system, communications, cable link, mission control center, which is a unique one in India, and then it is on par with Puru and other facilities, where all experts will be sitting and mission executives will be watching the flight events, and satellite preparation facility and photography. And coming to the range tracking system, basically, just I will give some brief introduction, and later I will go to the what are the requirements for the radars and other facilities. And range tracking systems, it is providing the range safety for the in the loop, man in the loop safety system. That is, while rocket is going the trajectory, so it should be a safe launching. It should not fall on the land masses. So if it is there also, a safety officer will be there always watching the movements of that one rocket launching.
It is there
and based
also
on that, he will take decision to go or no go. So for that, it is called a man-in-loop rain safety system.
And then
it gives the track of the re-entry objects, that is for the space debris or human space mission, all these things also come under this category for RLV tracking and all those things. And we get the position, time and velocity. These three parameters we will get from the radars. In the shore center, Sriharikota, we are having, there are P1, P2, P3, and radar 2, P4 radar. There are six radar systems are there. Basically, it is a diversity of the radars for the tracking operations, for smooth tracking operations.
Diversity of the
and then optical tracking systems, two systems are there. And telecommand systems, there are three chains, telecommand 1, telecommand 2, and telecommand 3. And then all these data are coming to the mission computers, and there will be a rain safety officer, what I told, he will take a decision. And there will be a mission control center where all executives will be sitting and then watching the flight events.
And
For the tracking, there are spectrum of sensors for the tracking. So, at the different frequencies or based on the IR or UV, according to that, here we are using electromagnetic things, that is radars, and infrared IR cameras. We are using that one. So these two things we are using at shore center.
Infrared IR cameras.
Coming to the radar systems,
so two things we are using at
this is a real time tracking during major missions like PSLV and GSLV. And even we do the atmosphere balloon tracking also for the atmospheric conditions for monitoring purpose, that is wind velocity, wind speed, and all those parameters to get that one. Because it is basically important parameters for the onboard computer to give the wind biasing on the date of launch. So that type of measurements also will be carrying out. Sounding rockets for the initial 200, 300 like this, all the sounding rockets for atmospheric studies, these radars are useful. So basically there are C-band radars and S-band radars. C-band consisting of 5.45 to 5.85 gigahertz, in S-band 2.7 to 2.9 gigahertz. We are using different types of radars of the conical scan and monopulse. Two varieties are there of the angle extraction.
We are using different types of radars.
But 1979 onwards, we are getting the radar, we are operating the radars at shore center. So initially, the technologies are all digital technologies with the logic gates in the initial thing, that is 1970s or 80s technology. Later, we switched over to VMU-based processors and controllers. That is PCMC radars, pulse coherent monopulse C-band radars. So which is developed by Bell along with ISRO. That is in 80s technology. That is processor and controller based. Later we have gone to the precision radars, two radars, one is in S-band and another one is in C-band. That is developed by L&T and ISRAD along with our shore partners. So that is based on the single board computers and FPGA technology. So as technology is growing up, our radars also is getting developed or augmented in this fashion.
As technology is growing up,
So these are the major specs of the radar systems. Only basically I want to touch upon the peak power what we are using is 1 megawatt. And then very high sensitive receivers of minus 140 dBW receivers, we are using that one. Antenna, very 4 meters antenna of 44 dB, like this we are using. The capability of range is for the, there are two things, one is skin mode and another one is transponder mode. The transponder mode more than 3000 kilometers, we can track the objects with the radars. So, this is all the tracking radars. Later, we are switched over to the Doppler weather radar in X-band also we have proposed. In this, basically, it is used for the monitoring of thunderstorms and the rain precipitation. For this also, we are proposing a X-band DWR radar. And the next one is the multifunction radar. In the morning session, Mr. Yusuf has told multifunction radar. This is multifunction pulse compression radar. This is not a new idea. Definitely, it is in USA. But in India, the first one we are proposing is multifunction. This is not the basically, radars are meant for the tracking of the launch vehicles, and the second one is the weather monitoring, and third one is surveillance. All three parameters, all three applications, we have kept in single radar, that we call it as multifunction pulse compression radar. Here, one more thing also, the whatever the transmitters we are using. The earlier one was the microwave tubes, which are the magnetrons and triodes, so which are obsolete. So we have gone for the solid state power amplifiers, in which the pulse compression is the one technique we are using to get the link margin of that 1000 kilometers range also with the skin mode. So that type of multifunction pulse compression radars also we are generating. It is being taken up. So it will be completed by March 2019. It is, and then with this radar also we can track. SSLV is our next program in the next year, for which we want to use this radar. For any radar, the range safety is the criteria for tracking the launch vehicles, for which some 700 kilometers or 800 kilometers are the range up to which the range safety requirements are met. So this radar will be useful for track up to that one. And coming to the one more development we are using is, I told you these triodes are obsolete. Because of that, the 1 megawatt transmitter, which is using the modulator, a triode, with which 40 kV pulse is generated and given to the magnetron for the oscillation purpose. Now, because of this obsolescence of this one, we are going for the solid state modulator, which is to be worked at 40 kilovolts, 40 kilovolts it should work, for which it is MOSFETs devices we are using. That work is going on, that development work is going on. Once it is proven by December 2018, we have made the design and given for the fabrication. Once it is ready, this type of solid state modulators we want to implement in other radars also, in the transmitters. And coming to the optical tracking system, as I told you, so far we are using the RF for the tracking systems, and the optics is also another parameter to get the tracking. So for that, CCD and IR cameras we are using. CCD is the limited one for 50 kilometers or so the range, whereas with IR, we are equivalent to 1000 to 1200 kilometers. We have tracked the launch vehicles where this PS1, PS2 separations also we can see, even PS2, PS3 separations also we have shown that one. So this is another area IR camera, so far we are importing. Now we are approaching Bell to prepare to make that IR camera suitable to our application. Next one is the telecommand system. It is also having one kilowatt or 2 kilowatts transmitters, which are working in VHF band. So that telecommand systems also are getting refurbished. So industry is participating in that. Then one more thing is the space debris. Space debris is very hazardous to our applications of satellites and our launch timings also. So for which we have to monitor the space debris, for which we are having telescope, we are proposing. Initially, a telescope of 14-inch is selected as an initial step, and for which these are the ranges to track the space debris size of some 10 centimeters there. Okay, the conditions are here is atmospheric conditions are important for this. And later we want to go for geosynchronous also to be monitored the space debris with higher dia of the lenses. The next one is the wind profiler. It's a radar. The wind speed and direction and gust and shears, all these things to be monitored. This is operated at 49 megahertz. It is getting the signal from the atmosphere of up to 21 kilometers, because our initial date of launch, wind biasing, all these things, we are monitoring our wind gust and shears and speed and directions up to 21 kilometers. Those data will be incorporated in the onboard computer to set the pitch roll and yaw. So for that purpose, this wind profiler is also 24/7 operation. It requires a lot of industrial support for this also. This wind profiler, the TR modules, antennas, and digital receivers. It requires a lot of and next one is very proud, we can say that we have developed the multi-object tracking radar, which is the cost at the time of we are inquiring, it is around 800 crores from for imported radar like this. But with our ISRO all centers, inter-centers collaboration and industry participation, we have made within 200 crores this radar. So in this, the basically it is a tracking for, so far all the radars we are having is the single object tracking radar. Whatever the forward moving is there, we are tracking that one. Whereas the rocket is having so many stages of first stage, second stage, third stage, and fourth stage in the PSLV or GSLV three stages. While it is falling down, the strap-ons and the spent hour stages also can be tracked with the help of this beam steering. That is a phased array radar, which is having electronics beam steering, plus or minus 60 degrees in azimuth, plus or minus 45 degrees in elevation. And space debris also one of the, in the lower orbits in the radars, they can use for the space debris tracking, this type of phased array radar. Whereas for geosynchronous type of thing, telescopes are generally used in elsewhere in the world. And then multi-object tracking radar for the ISRO future missions like reusable launch vehicles, human space missions. This phased array radar is can track 0.25 square meter target, that is 50 centimeter by 50 centimeter target at the range of 1,000 kilometers. Whereas if it is 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter, that is 0.1 square meters at the range of 800 kilometers, it can track. So these are the brief spec of the important thing. Here also, this is also pulse compression is used here, solid state power amplifiers of TR modules. The antenna is 12 meter by 6 meters, is a rectangular array used with microstrip patch antenna. Here 4608 elements are used here.
a rectangular
4608 antenna elements, 4608 TR modules are used in this phased array antenna, which is having this scan angle of plus or minus 60 degrees, plus or minus 45 degrees. If you want to cover entire 360 degrees, means three such radars are required in the 120 degrees apart, so that entire 360 degrees can be covered with this. And it is also used with pulse compression things. It is a single beam, multi, it is a multiple target tracking. It can be used here. This is in L band. This is in L band. 1.3 to 1.4 gigahertz, because already we are having S band radars and C band radars. To avoid the frequency interference, we have gone with L band radar. And this is the best example for the Indianization, what we have used antenna from the SAC and Indian industry, TR module from Indian industry, and feeder network from SDS ISRO, digital receiver and RF front end with the VSSC and ISRO combination, data processing at ISRO, mechanical structure with ISRO and Indian industry. Radome alone is the imported component here. It is a very huge radome of 18 meter diameter. So because of that, we have gone for the, with the limited time, we want that radome. That's why we have gone for the foreign vendor, AFC, antenna for communications, USA. Okay, this is the huge structure. So you please visit ISRO to see this MOTR, prestigious one.
This is the
which one, sir? Yeah. So it is a lot of good technical challenges we have met. We have achieved all these things. And one more thing also, one trailer mounted mobile MOTR, multi object tracking radar, also is we have done it. You see, transmitter, magnetron based things are there, and SSPA, that is solid state power amplifier based things, are there. The imported components here are magnetron, triode, and all high voltage power supply and these things. Here, power amplifiers. So these things, industries can think of to make here itself. And so far, source of supplies are all these things are source of supply. They are getting from other countries and then giving to us the finished product. And for antenna also, the feed, slip rings, rotary joints, TR limiters, encoders, all these things are the imported components we are using. Even in the array antenna also, we are using the same. Okay, power dividers and power combiners now we are getting in the industry, Indian industry itself nowadays. And the sources of supply are this. And whereas for the receivers, it is microwave integrated ICs and all those things we are getting imported. And the signal then data processing, that is also ADCs and FPGA boards, Xilinx boards we are getting, and the single board computers also imported items. But locally they are available with the industries. So the cost of the things are 800, but imported items are 530 crores in that. So Indian industry can help us in getting this type of components and microwave circuits. So with this, my presentation is over. Thank you all.